Coming up this week on our church life together, today is World Communion Sunday. So if you haven't yet gathered your communion elements, some bread, wine, or juice, you can do so while I make the rest of these announcements, and then you can rewind the tape later just so you don't miss anything. I would also like to let you know that Pastor Paul will be hosting Holy Grounds Coffee Hour on Sundays, beginning on the 4th of October from 11 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. This is designed to be a time of fun and fellowship and just to get some face time with each other. So just find that big old cup of coffee on our Bridges to Learning page, click on it, and poof, you'll be on holy ground. I know, right? All of the learning opportunities continue as listed on our order of worship, which is accessible right under this video on our Bridges to Learning page of the website. This coming Tuesday, breakfast in your PJs will be happening at 8:30. Shea Darien, our member in discernment here at the Church of the Palms, will be sharing at a time on the topic grieving our losses and healing during a time of COVID. Remember that on this coming Wednesday, our Board of Evangelism and Growth will meet at 10 a.m. And then on Thursday at 9, our nominating committee will begin the task of putting together groups of people who will work in ministry on our various boards and committees within the Church of the Palms. I'm confident that they will be praying and earnestly seeking God's direction for their work during these several weeks. And I also trust that you will be prayerful and consider God's direction for your life as you are asked to serve on a board or a committee. It will take all of us working together to provide all the types of ministry that our community needs in these days. Again, these two board meetings will be accessible on our Bridges to the Boards page of the website. The neuropathy support group led by Scott Patrick will meet on campus this coming Thursday, October the 8th, in King Hall at 10 o'clock. They're going to be masked and they're going to be socially distanced. And so if you believe that you might benefit from the neuropathy support group, come on down and be a part of that. And finally, don't forget the drive-up pet blessing on Sunday, October the 18th. Load up your pets in your vehicles and come on down to the church parking lot. We're going to have several folks directing traffic along the sidewalk side of that parking lot. Our masked pastor will come to your window and say a word of blessing. It's going to be a tail wagging good time, so come on down from 9 a.m. to 10:30. That and all the other opportunities of worship and service and ministry are there for you in all of our printed material and on our website. God bless you as we begin our worship together. Pastor Paul, why don't you come and welcome us today?
Thanks, Pastor Jim. I'm Pastor Paul. You've already met Pastor Jim. And welcome to the Church of the Palms, part of the United Church of Christ. We welcome you. I'm dressed a little differently than normal. And that's because we're celebrating a special time this during this video worship. World Communion Sunday. I'm wearing an outfit from Ghana that I got when I was on sabbatical 10 years ago in the rural section of the country. Now, that's where my son and I went, and the elders in that community wore outfits like this. Young folks, they wanted button-up shirts like people in North America. Old men, they wore this type of outfit, and I'm wearing this to honor them. World Communion reminds us that we are interconnected. God's love crosses boundaries of denomination, creed, and faith. Today, as you prepare to celebrate communion, I invite you to think internationally. Think creatively. Get in your elements to symbolize God's love, the symbols of bread and cup. Pastor Jim has written a great liturgy for us for communion. Wendy has prepared the table for us. All we need is you. Know that wherever you are on your journey, you're welcome here at the Church of the Palms. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Across a vast spectrum of thought and time, we present different quotes in our spiritual readings segment of worship. Today we have Apollo 11 astronaut Buzz Aldrin revealing that he participated in communion after landing on the moon. It was interesting to think that the very first liquid ever poured on the moon and the first food ever eaten there were communion elements. Glennon Doyle, previously known as Glennon Doyle Melton, is an American author known for her number one New York Times bestsellers, Untamed, Love Warrior, and bestseller Carry On Warrior, said this: "One day we will finally see that when we reject a person or a group of people, we reject a part of our very selves. All are one. All are in. All are God's beloved children with a place at the table." American author and pastor Max Lucado wrote, "There is a time for risky love. There is a time for extravagant gestures. There is a time to pour out your affections on one you love. When the time comes, seize it. Don't miss it."
Holy, holy, holy.
Our scripture lesson today comes from Philippians chapter 2, and I'll be reading verses 1 through 5. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you please pray with me? May the words of my mouth, the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. People love to talk about food. Their favorite food, their least favorite food. If you're ever in need of a conversation starter, a prompter, try this one. Do you know any weird or funny dining habits? There'll be no shortage of stories. The table, it seems, is the one place where all of us have some experience. Like my dad, who, well, loves to recite the following. There are two kinds of people in this family, the quick and the hungry. Another verse my dad would like to share. Maybe you've heard it before, said it before. I eat my peas with honey. I've done it all my life. It makes the peas taste funny, but it keeps them on my knife. So being a dad and keeping with the, well, weird table habits, I have done my best to pass them on. Let's not call them strange, but unique dining habits, pass them on to my children. So when I eat an orange, I eat the peel too. When I eat a shrimp, I eat that crunchy tail too. Now, where did I learn such strangeness? From my father, of course. But here's the exciting thing, exciting news. My daughter is taking after me. Isn't it great to see important family traditions passed on from one generation to the next? Well, but before you never allow the sensational Whitlocks to sit near you at the table again, I bet some of you have some strange eating habits too. I say that because, well, I've been watching. I won't mention any names, but I imagine there are some of you out there, well, who don't like your servings intermingling, don't like the veggies touching the entree or the potatoes to get too close to the dessert. I know people who will refuse to eat if the portions get mixed together, like they're gonna stay separate as they go through you. Wow. There's probably some folks out there, well, who eat their food in a certain order as well. Eat the veggies, then the potatoes, then the entree. There are some in my family who want to eat dessert first. The thought? Think of the people on the Titanic who were eating salad, you know, iceberg lettuce. When they hit that iceberg, the frozen one, not the leafy one, when they hit that iceberg, the ones who didn't eat dessert first didn't get any dessert. And let me tell you, that's a sinking feeling. Maybe you can remember the days of your childhood when you would smuggle unwanted food, the dreaded lima beans, mushy peas, grandma's rock hard biscuits, to your friendly furry pets. And then smiling innocently as a parent applauded a clean plate. The kitchen table of Wendy's childhood had a small shelf that ran underneath the table. Underneath the tabletop, a small shelf ran underneath it. It really wasn't noticeable to adults, but with little ones, with little fingers who love to touch everything and think nothing of, well, where their fingers have been, that little lip of a shelf under the table provided an excellent place to store all the vegetables that seemed impossible for her mouth as well as her young mind to swallow. She got away with her trickery for years. She only got caught when her parents moved 3 years ago. Well, what I have found is that everyone has a table story because, well, everyone has a history at the table. Whether it was a campfire in the jungle or a breakfast bar in your kitchen or a culinary castle in Manhattan, you learned early that the table had your basic needs supplied. Every house has some place where you eat. Even if it's a coffee table around the TV, every house, every home has a table. Even the house of God, or perhaps I should say, especially the house of God. There's a table in God's house. Let's journey to its embrace. One of the first things that, well, I notice about God's table is that it's long. It includes people that look like us, act like us, and think like us. But it also includes people who are different in appearance, behavior, thought, processes, culture, and faith practices. Now, at our table, we invite friends and family. The table of God's house includes places for everyone, including the people you and I wouldn't invite, our enemies. God's table is where all of us find acceptance. And I believe we can learn a great deal about people by the way they eat. One father tells a story of sitting around the kitchen table with his family, and he put a plate in front of both of his daughters, and in the center of the table was a collection of food, some fruit, some veggies, and some Oreo cookies. Every day, he explained, God prepares for us a plate of experience. What kind of plate do you most enjoy? The answer was obvious and easy. Sarah put 3 cookies on her plate. Some days are like that, aren't they? Some days are 3 cookie days. Many are not. Sometimes our plate has nothing but veggies, and not the ones you and I like, but the ones that make us, well, gag a little. Apparently, God knows that we need strength. And though the portion may be hard to swallow, it's good. It's for our own good. Most days have a bit of all. Veggies, which are healthy, fruit, which tastes a little better, at least from my perspective, and even an Oreo or two, which does little for our nutrition, but a whole lot for our attitude. All are important, all are from God. The next time your plate has, well, more broccoli than apple pie, remember who prepared the meal. And the next time your plate in life has a portion you find hard to swallow, don't hide it under the table or give it to the furry family friend, the dog. Give it to God. Talk to God about it. That's what Jesus did. Jesus talked to God about it. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when God handed him a cup so of suffering that was, well, so sour, so vile, that Jesus handed it right back to God. That's what he did. Abba, which means more than father, it means daddy. He prayed, Abba, if it is possible, take this cup away from me. But not as I want, but as you want. Even Jesus was given a portion in life that, well, he found hard to swallow. But with God's help he did. And with God's help in our lives, with the support of the community of faith, we can too. The table of God is abundant. God's table is long. It wraps around the entire world. The chairs are many and the food is ample. And at this table, God and we reserve the right to accept everyone. All of God's children are included, invited, a welcome. You don't need to act a certain way. You don't need to dress a certain way. There's no litmus test or cover charge. You don't have to come in costume or hide from your true self. I think that's an important piece. When we come to the table, we come as ourselves, not who we pretend to be, not who your family may think you are, but as you. And I've got some great news for you. If you can come as yourself, it is a holy experience. Even with all our weird habits and cultural customs, something holy happens at this table. There is a grace that flows. There's a spirit that enlivens. There's a hope for the hopeless. There's courage for the downtrodden. There are people gathering today in grand cathedrals, in simple huts, in storefronts, in country churches. The world is gathering this day to celebrate God's invitation to the table, where we all have a place, we all have a place, and everyone is accepted. How appropriate, then, that we have gathered with our sisters and brothers around God's table in God's house. Thanks be to God.
One God.
God formed the universe in wisdom and created all things with extravagant love. God set us in families on the earth to live in faith and to so order our steps that all people might live in hope and abundance. What a mighty God. As we come to an opportunity to consider the praise we might offer because of God's great love for us, for the good gifts of bread and wine, the table that is spread in the world as a sign of love and communion for all people, let us remember that our time, talent, and treasure are also signs of our love for justice, our neighbors, and the very planet we inhabit. Give generously with great love and cheer.
Gathering God, joined as one family, we come to your table today, mindful of the breathing of life that you have called into being across countries and climates, all creatures and all creeds.
Jesus, teacher, friend, today you invite us to feed on you so that we might feed others. Let our hunger for justice and our desire for peace never be exhausted until all of your children are safe and fed.
Life-giving Spirit, let your words reach out and open our ears and your movement in our souls in this time together. Bless, comfort, disturb us, so that the work of your followers here may be directed along right paths for the sake of the world. Amen. Table, you bid us come. You have set the places. You have poured the wine, and there is always room, you say, for one more.
And so we come.
From the streets and from the alleys,
we come.
From the deserts and from the hills,
we come.
From the ravages of poverty and from the palaces of privilege,
we come.
Running, limping, carried,
we come.
We are bloodied with our wars. We are wearied with our wounds. We carry our dead with us, and we reckon with their ghosts.
We hold the seeds of healing. We dream of a new creation. We know the things that make for peace, and we struggle to give them wings. And yet, to your table,
we come.
Hungering for your bread,
we come.
Thirsting for your wine,
we come.
Singing your song in every language, speaking your name in every tongue, in conflict and in communion, in discord and in desire,
we come.
O God of wisdom,
we come.
These are the words that have echoed in the mouths and hearts of countless followers throughout countless generations who have gathered around a table in community, breaking bread, and sharing the fruit of the vine with Christ, our Savior. And today, we share in this sacred meal, joined as one body in Christ with Christians around the world this day, in grand cathedrals, in tiny churches, in homes, and shared in many languages and cultures. We gather around this table where Christ is the host, and we, as followers of Jesus, are invited to share this sacred meal. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right to give you our thanks and praise, O God, for you watch over the strangers and the needy and raise us from death to into new life. You have made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them. You raised up prophets among your people and through them spoke your word of life and truth. Jesus lived among us as one who showed compassion, who opened the eyes of the blind, lifted up those who were bowed down low, gave food to the hungry, and set the prisoners free of death. When the powers of death rose up against him and destroyed him, you spoke your word of life again, raising him to new life as the revelation of your grace, who will reign forever in justice and truth. So we lift our voices, filled with joy, joining them with the glad songs of every place and generation, all creation praising your name. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Will you join me as we pray together? We thank you that your Spirit is poured out on all people. Send your Spirit now on us and on these gifts of bread and wine, that we may know Christ's presence, real and true, and be his faithful followers, showing your love for the world. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours
forever. Amen.
The bread, the life of Christ, broken. The cup of salvation, God's love poured out for all people. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Please join me in prayer. Holy God, we have been fed with the bread of life, the life of Christ. Let this holy food sustain us through our earthly pilgrimage until we come to that place where hunger and thirst are no more. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
May God's grace flow freely in our life together. May Christ's love take us on a journey of compassion. And may God's Spirit grant us courage to act with love. Amen and amen.